Hello everyone, welcome back. The topic for today is balanced occlusion from complete denture. Now what do you mean by balanced occlusion? So the definition for it is the simultaneous contacting. Simultaneous is at the same time. So the simultaneous contacting of the maxillary and the mandibular teeth. That means your maxillary and the mandibular teeth, they are contacting at the same time on both the sides, that is right and left, and in the anterior and the posterior occlusal area. So it is developed to lessen or limit the tipping or the rotating of the denture basis in the relation to the supporting structures. So why do you need this balanced occlusion? So you basically need this balanced occlusion so that you can limit the tipping or the rotation of your denture, because if you don't have this balanced occlusion in your complete denture, then your denture, it will rotate or it will tip with relation to the supporting structure. And this definition of balanced occlusion is given by glossary of prosthodontic terms. And the most important thing that you have to remember is, now this balanced occlusion, it is absent in natural dentition. So you can get this balanced occlusion only in the fabrication of your complete denture or any other fixed partial dentures. So now what are the requirements of balanced occlusion? So in this, all teeth, it should glide evenly against the opposite teeth. So first is, now your all teeth, that is the teeth from the maxilla, it should glide evenly. That means your teeth, they are gliding evenly without any problems. The next requirement is, no single tooth, it should provide any interference of other. And the third requirement is, there should be contact in the balancing side, but they should not interfere with the smooth gliding movements of the working side. Now for example, if you are doing the lateral movement, so in that case, if your mandible is moving in the left direction, so now your working side becomes the side in which your mandible is moving, and balancing side is the opposite of your working side. So in this, now there should be proper contact on your balancing side. But now if the teeth, they are contacting each other on the balancing side, so you have to see that now this balanced occlusion, it should not interfere with the gliding movement of your working side. So these are the various requirements of the balanced occlusion. Now what is the importance of it? So this is one of the most important factors that can affect your denture stability. Now in the definition also we have seen that it is used to limit the rotating or the tipping of the denture. So this is the most important factor for your denture stability. So the absence of the occlusal balance, it will result in leverage of the denture during the mandibular movement. So if there are any mandibular movements, like if the person, he protrudes, or if he is doing the lateral movements, so in that case, if there is no balanced occlusion, then your denture, it will move. That means your denture, it will rotate or it will tip. So this is the most important factor for your stability of the denture, that is balanced occlusion. Now there's a statement which is given by Schaeffert. So he says that enter bolus, exit balance. So what does that mean? Now it means that when, now over here, this is the case in which the balanced occlusion is present. Now as soon the person, he eats, so now you can see over here, so this is the bolus. So when the person is eating, there is the gap which is created and the balance occlusion, it is lost. So that statement, it says that enter bolus. That means as soon as you're eating something, the balanced occlusion is lost. So according to this statement, the balancing contact, it is absent when the food, it enters the oral cavity. Now this makes us think that balanced occlusion, it has no function during mastication, and so it is not essential in complete denture. So there was a person named Brewer who reported the importance of this balanced occlusion. So he stated that on an average, a normal individual makes the masticatory tooth contact only for 10 minutes. So that means now he has done some studies and he had said that normal individual, he eats and he has this contact tooth contact during eating only for 10 minutes in a day. So now this 10 minutes, it is compared to the 4 hours of the tooth contact during other function. So now for this 4 hours, now you require this balanced occlusion to maintain the stability of the denture. And hence, balanced occlusion is more critical during the parafunctional movements. Like if the patient, they are grinding or they are clenching. So in that cases, now this balanced occlusion is more important. So now it means that the person, he is only eating for 10 minutes, but now there are tooth contact for 4 hours, like for any other parafunctional movements. So that means now for this 10 minutes, you cannot ignore this 4 hours. So that means now this balanced occlusion is important for the other functions rather than the masticatory tooth contact. So this is the importance of your balanced occlusion. Now what are the general considerations of balanced occlusion? So the first is, now ideal balanced occlusion can be achieved in cases with wide and large ridges in complete denture with the teeth which are arranged close to the ridge. So now you can get ideal balanced occlusion in the cases of ridge which are large and wider. The next one is the complete denture that have teeth arranged away from the ridge, and the ones which are like resting on the short and narrow ridges, it will have poor balanced occlusion. So the balanced occlusion is good for your wide and large ridges, and when the teeth, they are arranged close to the ridge. And if it is opposite, that means if your ridge is narrow and it is small and the teeth, they are arranged away from the ridge, so in that case you will have poor balanced occlusion. Now in this, the teeth that have narrow buccolingual width and those they rest on a wide ridges, they provide the ideal balanced occlusion. Now the next consideration is ideal balance. It can be achieved by arranging the teeth slightly on the lingual side of the crest of the ridge. So if you are arranging the teeth buccally, so it will lead to poor balanced occlusion. So you have to remember that whenever you are arranging the teeth, so you can arrange them slightly lingually. So these are the various general consideration for your balanced occlusion. Now what are the various types of balanced occlusion? So there are basically four types of balanced occlusion. First is unilateral. Now as the name says, unilateral is the balanced occlusion. It is present only on one side. So this type of balanced occlusion, it is not followed during a complete denture construction. Instead, this unilateral type of balanced occlusion, it is used in FPDs. Now the next type is bilateral. So now in this, the balanced occlusion, it is present on both the side, as we have seen in the definition that there is simultaneous contact of the teeth, that is your maxillary and the mandibular teeth, on both the side, that is right and left, in centric and eccentric positions. So this bilateral balanced occlusion, it helps to distribute the occlusal load evenly through the arch, and therefore it helps to improve the stability of the denture. Now the next type of balanced occlusion is protrusive. So this type of balanced occlusion, it is present when the mandible, it moves in the forward direction. So when your mandible, it is moving in the forward direction, that means it is a protrusive balanced occlusion. So you'll see that in this, the teeth, it should contact simultaneously in the anterior and the posterior direction. Therefore in this, you have to see that there should be at least 3-point contact. That means there should be contact in the posterior, so there should be 2 contact in the posterior region and there should be 1 contact in the anterior region in this protrusive balanced occlusion. So this type of protrusive balanced occlusion, it is absent in the natural dentition. Now the next type of balanced occlusion is a lateral balanced occlusion. So now again, lateral balanced occlusion, it is absent in the normal dentition, and it is when the mandible, it is moving in the left or the right direction. So if your mandible is moving laterally, that means it can move in the left direction or it can move in the right direction. That becomes your lateral balanced occlusion. So again, in this, there should be contact between your maxillary and the mandibular teeth. But you will see that in this lateral, there will be minimal simultaneous 3-point contact, that is your 1 anterior and 2 posterior contact, which is present during the lateral movement of the mandible. So that is your lateral balanced occlusion. That means when your mandible, it is moved laterally. Like for example, in the natural dentition, now if you see, if your mandible, it is moving in this left direction, for example, so you'll see that there will be contact only of the canines in your natural dentition. Rest all teeth, there will be no contact. So you'll see that there is no contact in all the teeth and there is only contact for your canine. Now for example, if this is the same thing, you'll see in the complete denture. Now because of this not contacting of all the teeth and just a 1-point contact, so in that case, now your complete denture, it will be unstable. That means your denture, it will have that denture instability. So what you need to do is, now in this lateral movement of your mandible, so there should be contact on the working side. That means all your teeth on the working side, they should have the proper contact. So this is the balanced occlusion, that is your lateral balanced occlusion. Now what are the factors which influence this balanced occlusion? So basically there are basic 5 factors that are inclination of the condylar path, that is your condylar guidance. The next factor is incisal guidance. The next one is the cusp angulation, compensating curve. And the fifth one is the plane of occlusion. So these are the five factors that can influence the balanced occlusion. So in this you have to see that the effect of incisal and the condylar guidance, it should be counteracted by the other three factors to obtain a balanced occlusion. So if there are any problems with this two, so you have to make the changes in this three factors, because now this two factors, it can be counteracted by this three factors, and through that only you can attain that balanced occlusion. So now starting with the first factor, that is the condylar guidance. So now this is the first factor of occlusion, and this is the only factor which can be recorded from the patient. That means you are doing that protrusive registration. Now in this, now you ask the patient to protrude the occlusal rim, and in this the interocclusal record material, it is injected between the occlusal rim. So now you have inserted the occlusal rim in the patient's mouth, and you are asking the patient to protrude his mandible, and then what you're going to do is you're going to fill this with the interocclusal record material, and then you're going to transfer this relation to an articulator. So this is nothing but protrusive registration. Now since the occlusal rims, they are in the protrusive relation, the upper member of the articulator, it is moved back to accommodate. Now what you have done in the condylar guidance is you have asked the patient to protrude. So because of that protrusion, now you have to compensate it on your articulator. So what you're doing is you're going to move the upper member of your articulator backward so that you're compensating it properly. Your condylar guidance, it can be recorded in the patient's mouth. So now if there is increase in the condylar guidance, so that will lead to increase in the jaw separation during protrusion. So if there is increase in this angulation, so because of that there will be increase in the jaw separation. As this condylar guidance, it is recorded in the patient, so because of that this condylar guidance, it cannot be modified. So this is the only main thing that you need to remember, that condylar guidance, it is not modified by the dentist. Rest all factors you can modify, but not this condylar guidance. So in patient with the steep condylar guidance, the incisal guidance, it should be decreased to reduce the amount of jaw separation. Now if the condylar guidance, it is steep, so in that case what you need to do is, now you need to reduce the incisal guidance so that you can get that proper balanced occlusion, or you need to do vice versa. So if the condylar guidance, it is shallow, so in that case you need to increase your incisal guidance, and if it is steep, then you need to decrease the incisal guidance. So this is why, because you want that proper balanced occlusion. Now the next one is the incisal guidance. So it is defined as the influence of the contacting surface of the mandibular and the maxillary anterior teeth on the mandibular movement. So if you are doing any mandibular movement, like if you are doing the protrusion or the lateral movements, so what is the influence of the contacting surface of your maxillary and the mandibular anterior teeth? That is nothing but your incisal guidance. Now there's one formula which is given in this, like incisal guidance by Swinson. So it says that incisal guidance is equal to 2 cusp angle minus average condylar guidance. Now for example, you have done your condylar guidance. So now for example, now on the right side you'll see the condylar guidance is 25 degree, and the left side you'll see the condylar guidance is 35 degree. So now the average of this 25 plus 35 upon 2, it will be 30 degree. So the average of your condylar guidance is now 30 degree. And if you're using, in this case you're using an anatomical teeth. Now we already know there are various types of teeth which are available, that are your anatomical, non-anatomical and semi-anatomical. So now all these teeth, they have particular angulation. Now anatomical, they have 33 degree. So for example, if you are using an anatomical teeth, so they have this 33 degree. So now in this formula, it says that IG is equal to 2 into the cusp angle. So your cusp angle is 33 degree minus 30. So that means now your incisal guidance is nothing but 36 degree. So this is the formula to calculate your incisal guidance. And if it is a semi-anatomical teeth, so it will be 20 degree. Now if it is a non-anatomic teeth, then it will be less than 10 degree. So these are the various like angulation for your teeth which you're using. Now this can be amongst this three, whether you're using anatomical, non-anatomical or you're using a semi-anatomical. So this is the most important determinant of occlusion, and it should be determined by aesthetic, that is the anterior trial, because now as it is a incisal guidance, that means now you are seeing the anterior region. So in this, now this incisal guidance is very important by the aesthetic point of view, because it is the anterior region. So many times students set a very shallow incisal guidance to obtain the balance. But now in this, now you have to see that such processes, it requires excessive occlusal correction. Almost it appears to have an open bite. So what we do is we end up like making this incisal guidance shallower. That means you're having a less angulation for this incisal guidance. So that means your incisor, maxillary incisor, it will have that proclination. Because of that proclination, your like angle, it will be a shallower angle. So there's a problem with this shallower incisal guidance, that most of the time it leads to the open bite. So you have to see that you have to maintain the aesthetics also, and you have to keep this incisal guidance also properly. It is called as a second factor of occlusion, and it is determined by the dentist. Now in this, now you are actually arranging the teeth. Now in condylar guidance, you cannot change the condylar angulation, so because of that it cannot be modified. But over here, this incisal guidance, it can be modified, as it is customized by the dentist, like depending on that anterior triene. So it acts as a controlling part. And one more point you need to remember for this incisal guidance is the incisal guidance, it has more influence on the posterior teeth than the condylar guidance. Now this is because the action of the incisal inclination, it is close to the teeth than the action of the condylar guidance. So hence, while arranging the anterior teeth for aesthetics, so in that case you have to keep in mind a proper overjet and the overbite to achieve that proper balanced occlusion. So now in this case, you have to see that whenever you are arranging your anterior teeth, you should have that proper incisal guidance, so that you are getting that proper aesthetics also, and you are getting that proper balanced occlusion also. Now moving on towards the third factor, that is the plane of occlusion. So it is defined as the imaginary surface which is related anatomically to the cranium and which theoretically touches the incisal edges. So over here, now it is touching the incisal edges of the incisor, the tips of the posterior teeth. Now it is not a plane in the true sense of a word, but it represents the mean curvature of the surface. So this is nothing but a plane of occlusion. So the occlusion plane, so now over here, for example, now you have your maxillary teeth, and over here now you have your mandibular teeth. So this is nothing but a plane of occlusion between this, that is, it is passing from the incisal edges of your anteriors and towards the cusps of your posterior. So that becomes your plane of occlusion. So now this plane of occlusion, it is established anteriorly by the lower canine and posteriorly by the retromolar pad. So you'll see that this line of occlusion, or the plane of occlusion, it is parallel to the allotragus line. So now in this, you have to see that the tilting of this plane of occlusion beyond 10 degree, it is not advisable. Now the next factor is the compensating curve. So compensating curve, it is defined as the anterior-posterior and the lateral curvature in the alignment of the occluding surface and the incisal edges of the artificial teeth, which are used to develop the balanced occlusion. So compensating curve is nothing but the curvatures. So this is nothing but a curve. So over here, curvature is nothing but a curve which you're getting anterior-posteriorly and laterally. So the curves which are going through the incisal edges and your tip, so that becomes your compensating curve. And this curve, they are used to develop that balanced occlusion, and it is an important factor for establishing the balanced occlusion. So it is determined by the inclination of the posterior teeth and their vertical relationship to the occlusal plane. So this is a very important factor for your balanced occlusion. Now there are two types of compensating curve, that is a anterior-posterior and a lateral. Now you know about that curve of Swee, Wilson's curve and Monson's curve. So these types of curves, they are only present in the natural dentition, but these curves, they are not present in the like artificial or your dentures. So now this compensating curve is nothing but they act like this three curves which are present in your natural dentition. So that becomes your compensating curve. So now you have to see that whenever you are arranging the teeth, so you have to arrange the teeth such that the occlusal plane, it forms a curve. So that plane, that curve is nothing but your compensating curve. So if now, for example, if your condylar guidance, it is steep. So in that case, you have to see that the compensating curve, it should also be steep. so as to get that proper balanced occlusion. There is shallow condylar guidance, so in that case again you need to give a shallow compensating curve. Now for example, in a steep condylar guidance you are giving a shallow compensatory curve, so in that case you will see that there will be loss of balanced occlusion as your balance between the molar, it is lost. So that becomes, like, you have to remember that whenever there is steep condylar guidance, that means the angulation is more for your condylar guidance, then the curve, it should also be steep. So this is the important factor that you need to remember. Now what is the anterior posterior compensating curve? So these are the compensating curves which are running in an anterior posterior direction, and this anterior posterior compensating curve, it compensates for the curve of Spee which is seen in the natural dentition. Curve of Spee is nothing but the one which is like passing from the incisal guidance and the cusp of your canine and then the cusp of your molars through the anterior border of the rapus, that becomes your curve of Spee. So now what is the significance of this curve of Spee? So in this, when the patient, he moves his mandible in the forward direction, so the posterior teeth, it sets on this curve. So now when the patient, he is moving his mandible in the forward direction, so what happens is your posterior teeth, it sets on this curve, and because of that there is this posterior contact which is present. Now if this curve of Spee is absent, so that will lead to the separation of your teeth, that is nothing but the Christensen's phenomena. So because of that you need that curve of Spee. Now this curve of Spee, it is present only in natural dentition, so the compensatory one for this is the anterior posterior curve. So you require this anterior posterior curve just to maintain that proper contact when the mandible is moving in the forward direction. Now the next type of compensatory curve is the lateral. So now we have seen that there are two types of compensatory curve. One is your anterior posterior that compensates for the curve of Spee, and the next one is the lateral. So lateral is when the mandible, it is moved in the lateral direction. So the Wilson curve and the Monson curve, then the reverse curve, Pleasure curves, they are the various curves which are used in the lateral movement of the mandible. So this lateral compensatory curve, it compensates for all these various types of curves that you can find in the natural dentition, just to compensate or to maintain that proper balanced occlusion when the mandible, it is moved in the lateral direction. So this is about the compensatory curve, that you have two types of curve in your compensatory curve, that is anterior posterior and lateral. Anterior posterior, it is used to compensate the curve of Spee, and the lateral, so the various types of curves which are present in the natural dentition, that are your Wilson, Monson, Pleasure, reverse. So in this, the lateral curve, it is used to compensate all these different types of curves. Now the last factor that is influencing the balanced occlusion is the cuspal angulation. Now as the name says, it is the angulation or the angle of the cusp. So it is the angle which is made by the average slope of the cusp with the cusp plane, which is measured mesiodistally or buccolingually. So that is nothing but the angulation of the cusp. So now if there is shallow overbite, so in that case what you need to do is you need to reduce the cuspal angulation. So if the angle, that is your incisal guidance, is less, so in that case you have to see that your cuspal angulation, it should also be less. Now there's one more formula which is given for this cusp angulation, again by Swinson's. So the formula, it says that the cusp inclination or the angulation is equal to the incisal inclination plus half of the distance from the incisal guidance, that is CG minus IG, that is your condylar guidance minus incisal guidance. Now for example, your condylar guidance is 40 and your incisal guidance is 30, so over here this half of the distance, it becomes 10. So now over here, now we'll see the formula, so you'll apply this. So the cuspal angulation is equal to 30, that is your cuspal inclination. Now we have seen, so your cuspal guidance, it is 30, so it is 30. So the next part is, it is plus half of the distance from the incisal guidance. So distance from the incisal guidance is nothing but the condylar guidance minus incisal guidance. So it is, now over here we have seen condylar guidance is 40, so it is 40 minus 30, so the angulation is 35 degree. So now your cusp angulation is 35 degree. So this is nothing but a formula that you can apply to see what your cusp angulation is. So now these are the various factors for your balanced occlusion. So now depending on this factor, you have to see that whenever you're arranging the teeth, so you have to arrange them in such a manner that you can attain that proper balanced occlusion. Now because your balanced occlusion is a very important factor for the denture stability. So this was all about the balanced occlusion. I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you so much.